Hey, Grappling Ignorance. I'm going to see if I can't clear up some confusion that's happening in this conversation, because there seems to be a tremendous disconnect between the words that people say to you and what you hear, or at least what you say you heard, and I'm going to see if I can't help you out with that. So take it away.
In a recent video, I agreed to a claim of the existence of male privilege in American culture. Many people get uncomfortable when they encounter a nuanced position that doesn't make assertions with complete conviction.
I'm going to infer that the reason you're mentioning that is to imply something about the commenters in your first video, the one about what you're speaking, that in some sense were those types of people who are uncomfortable with nuanced positions, were uncomfortable with positions that aren't stated very strongly, that don't have total conviction or whatever, which is a bit strange because if you go back and read the comments, from my side of the argument at least, no one is raising the objection that, you know, the problem with this video, Grappling Ignorance, is that it's just too nuanced, man. I'm uncomfortable. I can't follow along. Can you make that argument simpler for me so I can really get just the thrust of what you're saying? And no one is arguing that, you know, your argument is just so mealy-mouthed. It's so weak and milquetoast. I mean, gosh, come on, man. Get some balls. Have some conviction. Believe what you're claiming. And the reason that we're not making that argument is because the section of the video to which we're referring, to which we're objecting, is a section of the video in which it isn't a nuanced position. It isn't an argument that is being represented cautiously. It isn't an argument that is being represented as being tentative or provisional. You said that it is certainly true that women are, in fact, the underprivileged gender. When someone says that something is certainly true, that it is certainly the case, they are representing strength. They are representing conviction. They are saying that this claim is definitely true. It is undeniably true. It is not to be doubted. It is irrational not to believe the truth of that proposition. It is unreasonable to fail to believe the truth of the proposition being proposed. And after having argued that, and having had that mentioned to you several times, you then make this video where you're saying, they're just uncomfortable that I didn't make a strong enough claim. The precise objection we're raising with respect to that is that the claim you're making is very strong, and you're doing it on no evidence at all.
Some consider it copping out of an argument if you don't throw down your money completely on one side or the other. Yet, on many issues, I find both sides are usually right about some things and wrong about others. Or they may both be right, but for different reasons. Some of those people on the ends of the spectrum just get as upset about people being somewhere in the middle as they do about people being on the opposite end, which in this case led to comments from feminists upset that I wasn't adopting their label, and from MRAs angry that
By the way, I'm not an MRA, but whatever.
I think male privilege happens to exist.
And for anyone who's keeping tabs, I'm not a feminist either.
The kind of questions I got on that topic were very telling of
Your representation of the questions you got on it is what is going to be very telling.
Misunderstanding of what it is that's meant by privilege. Questions like, what laws on the books are against women, and if there's nothing legally holding women back, then how can they possibly be underprivileged, etc.
So, the argument that you're being presented on the legal front is not that. And if you pay attention to nothing else I ever say, focus very carefully here because I'm going to spell it out. I'm going to spoon feed this to you to help you along so that way you will finally fucking get it and stop pretending that the argument is what you want to represent it to be instead of what it actually is. There are two necessary parts in that argument. You say, I'll ignore the second one and only focus on the first. The two parts to it are the following. One, can you cite to any law that exists that grants to any man, to grants to men, a benefit, a privilege, an entitlement, an immunity, a special right that simultaneously denies that to any woman? No, you can't. No such law exists. Part the second, pay attention, focus, put your thinking cap on, Mr. Teacher, stay on task. Part the second, can you find laws that grant to women special rights, special privileges, special benefits, special entitlements, or special immunities that simultaneously prohibits men from enjoying that? Yes, you can, and it is trivially easy to do this. The people who are raising this argument, which has those two parts to it, we're presenting you with example after example after example of laws that exist that give women special benefits, that give women special privileges, that give women special rights, and categorically denies it to all men. Now, in such a system, you have it the case that it is the official policy in black letter law that women have rights that are denied to men. Women have benefits that are denied to men. Women have entitlements that are prohibited for men to enjoy those. It is unlawful for men to have those. You can be sent to prison for trying to give men these rights. You can go to jail and be fined if you try to give to men the same thing that is enjoyed by all women. And then you say it's the women who are underprivileged. You can't find it in the law, which means that it has to exist somewhere outside of the law. And you're being asked, where outside of the law is it to be found? And you can point to no fucking where that it exists. Nevertheless, you claim it is certainly true. It is definitely the case. It is undeniably the case. It is irrational to disagree with you that, in fact, women are underprivileged relative to men. And then you give this one minor exception. There are some cases where it's not universally true. We're asking you for one place where it is true and you can't cite to it, or to the extent that you're able, you refuse to do it. Now, Steven Pinker has a great lecture where he's talking about what it means to argue honestly. And when you present an argument, you should have at your ready disposal five or six examples that serve not to definitely prove, but to shore up the truth of the proposition you're proposing, be it evidence, be it logical arguments, be it scientific studies, something, five or six things that you can readily cite to send people, go look at this, go look at that, go look at the other, to indicate that there is something other than just making shit up and pulling it out of your ass behind what it is that you're saying. This you refuse to do. And then you say, we simply don't understand. And then you claim that I'm not making any definite claims. I'm not saying this, blah, blah, blah. This is a very weak claim. No, it isn't. You are claiming that we are unreasonable if we do not immediately agree with the truth of the proposition you proposed, which was that it is certainly the case that women are, in fact, the underprivileged gender. Okay. Now you can go back to being completely vacuous and oblivious to reality, like you've been doing for the last week or so.
I hope to tackle that misunderstanding here. Most people resent being told that they are privileged, and for good...
People who aren't privileged do tend to resent being told that they are, in fact, privileged.
Reason. It feels like it devalues anything a privileged person accomplishes.
You know, when you walk by a homeless guy and you're like, oh my God, look at all this. I mean, you know, I used to make this as a joke. You have to go to like Eddie Bauer or the Gap or whatever to buy jeans. And they do this at the factory, whatever. They fade them out and they, you know, they make them look all rough and worn and everything. And homeless people get that look for free just by living on the streets and having their clothes having their clothes ripped and whatnot and getting all dingy and grimy. I had to pay like $75 for a pair of jeans to look that good. Holy shit. Why are these homeless people so goddamn privileged?
Dangerous is for...
For those of you who weren't following along, they aren't. And it would be obscene to walk up to people who clearly are in the lowest rungs of society and say, you need to check your privilege, Mr. Homeless Person. Getting those jeans all from, you know, you just get that look all naturally. You don't have to spend any money to look that poor.
Underprivileged group to use that as an excuse to not bother aspiring to achieve because they begin the race well behind the starting line while others get a significant head start. So why bother? I've also resisted claims of privilege myself because I was being told that due to my privilege over another group, I couldn't possibly understand them. I wholeheartedly reject that as an absurd notion, as my sense of empathy is not limited to those with whom I share every observable demographic. I may not know exactly how it feels to fall under every demographic on the planet, but I can still understand them by listening to them and drawing from my own experiences to make a connection. I've never been strapped into an electric chair, so I don't know what that feels like exactly, but I can certainly empathize with someone who's about to be executed based on thought experiments, listening to the descriptions of people who've been on the verge of their own demises, and comparing it to different types of near-death experience of my own. But that rejection of mine shouldn't be so broad-sweeping as to resist the privilege of which I'm being accused or assigned. So, If you're only bringing up privilege to devalue someone else's accomplishments, insist that they can't possibly understand you, or provide an excuse for why you or a group shouldn't bother trying to work at success within the current system, then you're contributing to the problem. You're being the key element to why the dominant demographics often reject the entire concept of privilege rather than accept it and work at it. So, what exactly is meant by privilege? Well, the unfortunate reality is that Monopoly, albeit a game largely dictated by the luck of a dice roll, is far more fair than life. In a game of Monopoly, everyone starts on the same square, dice rolls affect them all the same, no matter what game piece each is playing with.
There's a colossal problem with this analogy, which I'll point out in a moment.
Everyone starts with the same amount of money, and as long as they have money, anyone can buy whatever each can afford if he or she lands on it. It would be great if the real world in America worked similar to that, but...
The real world doesn't work similar to a Monopoly game, because we aren't showing up in a place where we can pull out the board afresh and go, okay, we are going to devise the rules by which a new universe is going to operate. So, for your analogy to be anything like relevant to what it is you're trying to model, what you'd have to do, instead of talking about the initial conditions, is talk about what it would be like if you walked in after the game has been going on for an hour and a half, and then saying, oh my god, that person who's losing is clearly underprivileged. I mean, look at the other people, they're doing better. Obviously, this person's getting a raw deal. This person is just reaping the consequences of the decisions that they've made and the decisions that other people have made. No one's disadvantaging, no one is prohibiting them from doing better. It is not, life is not a game, as you know, although there is a game called Life, where you get, where would the initial condition be? Is it with every birth we have to take away everything that everybody has and say, sorry, we got to start over so everyone gets, you know, a perfectly equal shake at things? No. You're coming into a game, Life, that's been being played for thousands of years and then looking around and saying, you know, I don't like where some of the players in this particular game are. Obviously, it's because they've been underprivileged.
It doesn't. Imagine if your game piece were chosen randomly, which gave each player a unique set of starting conditions he or she has no control over. Some people start with a go directly to jail card, some start with a get out of jail free card, some start on free parking, and people have radically different amounts of starting money, while some start the game with already...
Curiously enough, the randomness is a way to bring about fairness, because it doesn't select anybody in particular. There are certain conditions that will be true, but no one is favored and no one is disfavored. You could get this particular starting condition, which might be wonderful, or you could get some other starting condition, which might not be quite as wonderful. The point about randomness is no one's making the decision, and the system is fair. Any sample is approximately equally likely to be drawn.
Property.
That's why when we do research, we like it to be random. So that way, nothing is favored. It just shakes out however it shakes out. That's the fairest way we can come up with it.
Now, apart from those starting conditions, all the other rules on paper may be exactly the same. But just because the game's the same doesn't mean it's even close to being fair with those starting conditions being altered.
But the starting conditions aren't being altered. Where is the initial condition for this particular event, for this particular game that we're playing? When do you start it? Do you start it with every birth? Do you start it every year? You don't start it. It didn't. There wasn't a moment in time you could point to and go, ah, that's where this game of life started.
If you see a game like that happening, and you can admit that some players don't have as good of a chance of winning as others, and we'd be better off if the game treated everyone the same from beginning to end, then congratulations.
Yes, and fat people don't run as far as marathon runners who run all the time. The fact that you're going to get completely different outcomes doesn't mean that marathon runners are advantaged or privileged. They've worked hard to get it. They've worked harder than other people. And they have a capacity that is denied to other people because of the other people's decisions, or because you like to do this on the basis of groups, because of the team players on team whatever you would like to have, the decisions that they've made. So here, with respect to the initial condition being when someone's, you know, the family they're born into, if you want to use that analogy, they are suffering or enjoying the consequences of their teammates, their parents. It's not someone else doing this to them. In a minute, we're going to talk about that, because Well,
so you've been able to recognize that some of those players had privilege. Economic privilege is the easiest to recognize because it's so quantifiable. Not many people would argue that if you're born rich, you're much luckier. Economic privilege is the easiest to recognize because it's so quantifiable. Not many people would argue that if you're born rich, you're much luckier than someone born poor, and your accomplishments in life will never be regarded as anywhere near as impressive as someone who accomplishes the same thing or things from a rags-to-riches background. This is so evident that hip-hop culture often strives to point out just how poor and ghetto an artist was prior to their current luxurious state, but makes essentially no effort to explain the hard work or specific means of achieving their success that they underwent. Their own culture would reject them if they were born rich, but if they started off poor, it makes members of their culture so vicariously euphoric for them that they want to send them even more of their own money to bolster that status. Economic status is only one demographic, though, just like starting money is only one factor that can affect a player's odds and how the game feels in our Monopoly example. Add in that if the banker doesn't like your game piece, then you get less than the $200 stipend for passing go, or that...
The thing about a game is, it operates by certain rules. The analog in reality is, we have laws. And if the banker is trying to fuck someone over, there are laws that prohibit that. Now, of course, writing something down on a sheet of paper doesn't mean that people won't do it, but it provides a remedy by which the people who are adversely affected by the wrongful conduct of another can seek to have their interests vindicated in a court of law, be it through civil litigation and money damages, or through criminal prosecution of the person who did the wrong thing, or a combination of both. Here you have individual people who are violating the rules of the game in order to fuck someone over. So if you're going to analogize this to the privilege in the real world, then you need to posit that there are agents intentionally choosing to fuck women over. Who are these people? It's clearly not the lawmakers, and it's clearly not every company in the world tripping over itself trying to recruit women so people will stop asking why they don't have more women. Who are the bad people who are making the decisions that are intentionally fucking women over? Please name them so we can get together and kneecap those assholes and finally get over this fucking nonsense.
Even if you can afford it, if the property manager doesn't like your game piece, there are certain properties that he's not willing to admit are for sale. Hopefully this helps you start to see, if you didn't already, why asking a question like how women or minorities can possibly be underprivileged if there aren't specific laws.
There are people who can choose to violate the laws to impose disabilities upon people that is not permissible to be imposed upon those people. And the people who have that imposed upon them have legal remedies at their disposal to use at their whim. And in point of fact, there are federal laws that are written which provide good sums of money to lawyers to take civil rights cases when criminal prosecutions can't be brought and when people can't afford to take civil rights litigations on their own. We are aware that not everyone is equally able to do things in society through no fault of their own. And we have laws in place so that way everyone has to play by the same baseline rules. And to the extent that you will here advert to a notion of privilege is to the extent that you have to posit an intentional agent choosing to inflict upon someone a disability, which we have already addressed.
Holding them back from advancing our society is a silly question. Let's get away from the game analogy and look at another demographic which most of my viewers can directly relate to. In America, Christian privilege is highly evident. Even though no laws exist banning companies from hiring atheists, if you're an open atheist who walks into an interview room with 4 to 5 executives that all happen to be fundamentalist Christians who know you're an atheist...
Okay, about 20% of the states in the United States have it written in their constitutions that atheists will be prohibited from certain things, to include certain kinds, well, variously depends on which state, but it runs the gambit. Some states prohibit atheists from being able to testify in court. This disables all atheists, at least on paper, from being able to go into court and to testify against someone who's beaten them for being an atheist. To the extent, again, that you're going to advert to a privilege or a differential treatment of people, you are claiming that there's no law that does this when there are laws that impose this very disability upon people. There are licensing requirements to do certain kinds of professions. Some of those licenses cannot be given to atheists in certain states. It is the official position of this, of these states that atheists are properly, it's improper for atheists to do certain things, and it is the preferred policy in writing of the state that atheists be discriminated against by law. And they do that by denying them licenses, so they can't get jobs at certain private companies, so they don't have to go write, if you have this kind of company, you can't hire atheists. They'll just do it on the front end by saying, we won't grant these licenses to atheists because they're not of good moral character, and that therefore disables them from a whole swath of private employment that they might otherwise have had. And indeed, this is the state doesn't go to the additional step of saying, look, because it's our official policy that atheists are horrible people, because it's our policy, we're not going to say that it has to necessarily be your company's policy, even though it's strongly encouraged. We will allow you, the religious people, to make their own decision consistent with your values. However, as a matter of official policy, these atheists will be disabled from being full citizens. They will be denied legal rights they'd otherwise be entitled to if only they said, I believe in God. In some places, it's so silly that if you even deny, you can believe in God, but deny that there's an afterlife, and you're still, by these state constitutions, disabled from certain benefits. So to the extent that you want to advert to a demographic that you claim is representative, is precisely to go back to the thing that you said is silly, talking about the law. There are laws that are written that impose upon atheists these disabilities. It is, of course, to the credit of many of these states, where it's actually written in their constitutions, that they just ignore it. But the fact that they ignore it doesn't mean that atheists still don't have to litigate these issues, because it is, after all, the law. And if it is, after all, the law, you do no injury, you work no mischief to someone by obeying what the law allows you to do. All right, I'm going to leave it here. Have a great day.